Good morning. Thanks for coming to this workshop. We have been trying to get people to share their ideas and congregate and talk about this new area, scientific machine learning. And I think I'm very encouraged by the participation. We have about 50 people right now. So, you know, I think it's very encouraging, and, you know, for the next few years, I think this is going to be a major effort here on campus. So what I'm going to present here is something that is really at the very preliminary stages. And, you know, this is work that has started recently. It's a collaboration with, first of all, my PhD student, Levi McClenny, and also with Raimundo Arroyavi, at the Material Science Department, and his student, Vahid. So the idea is...
Ulysses, yes? Can I interrupt the words? If you read the comments, can you switch from presenter mode to normal mode so we can see your full screen? Could you hit the swap displays on the top to go to full screen?
So let's see how I can.
It's a button at the top, right at the top. Top, great.
Okay, perfect. There you go. There you go. All right. So the idea is for materials science. Which is the context we are discussing here. One of the most important problems for materials design is the quantitative, is to quantify the structure property relationships. So I'm gonna be using this context here, even though this is a general idea. So on one side you have, to go back, okay. So one side you have a structure, which is the input. So this is the data, okay? So you have, you know, maybe you have micrographs, you have calculations, properties, et cetera, processing properties, et cetera. And on the other side, you have property, performance of the material, microstructure evolution, fracture propagation, properties, like I said, of the material. And then the process of going from the left to the right is the forward modeling process, as the prediction process. The process of going from the right to the left is the inverse modeling process, or the inference process. And in the middle here, we have our module, our scientific machine learning model. And the scientific machine learning module consists of a machine learning module and physical laws. So, and is this interaction here between the machine learning module and the physical laws that characterize scientific machine learning. So scientific machine learning is still machine learning. Okay, first of all, it's not something different. We still wanna do prediction, we still wanna do inference, but it has this new component of physical laws, if you will, that constrain and guide the inference process. So that means that you're gonna need much less data, you know, dramatically less data to be able to do your predictions and your inference. And you're also gonna get a model which is interpretable. You know, it has physical meaning, has interpretation, and is also robust. So, I mean, these are the major advantages of using the scientific machine learning process. I mean, I believe personally that for engineering applications, scientific applications, this is going to be the dominating paradigm going forward, okay? So people are not gonna use data-driven machine learning, pure data-driven machine learning in scientific and engineering domains. So the next stop is, you know, so now I'm going to use some simple models to illustrate the process. So the previous slide is the future, let's say, what we want to do from materials design. But here I'm gonna show you some simple models of how we can accomplish this. So here I'm showing you a very simple one-dimensional nonlinear PDE, which is used in to model microstructure evolution. It's the Allen-Kahn equation, okay? So this is a one-dimensional problem. Here's the solution down here, and you can see this is time on the bottom, and this is the spatial dimension, the vertical axis. So here we can see the evolution of this solution. And we can see that, so it is going, this Allen-Kahn equation is gonna model two-phase microstructure evolution. So you can see that there are some sharp transitions. There is basically two phases. and this is one of the PDEs that is used to model microstructure evolution. We can see that there are some sharp transitions in the solution. Very sharp transitions, some high frequency, some, you know, fast varying transitions as well. So this makes it very difficult. It's a highly nonlinear process, and it makes it really difficult to approximate. So let's look at the next slide. So So the basic technology here that has recently been proposed is the physically informed neural network. So consider a general PDE. I'm sorry. Consider a general PDE. So it's a nonlinear PDE. Okay, this is a differential operator, spatial time differential operator. And so this is a completely general nonlinear PDE. This is the domain. Spatial domain, and this is the time domain. And this is the boundary condition. And I'm sorry, these are the boundary conditions, yes, and this is the initial condition, okay? So boundary conditions and initial condition. So the idea to solve such a PDE, so to obtain a solution of this PDE, you can use two neural networks. So one is called the approximation deep neural network. W denotes the network weights. And the other one is called the residual deep neural network. And the residual deep neural network is essentially computed by automatic differentiation methods. So it applies the spatial time operator on this neural network. Okay, on the output of this neural network. So you have two neural networks. This one is constructed by automatic differentiation methods. So they share the same weights, W, okay? So the idea is to train these two neural networks to solve this. U is gonna approximate it, and R is the residual. So the way that you can do this is by using a loss function, which looks like this. It has four terms. The first term, constrains the solution to satisfy any sample data that you have, okay? So interior data, sensor data, observations in the interior of the domain, okay? And this is a simple mean square error loss function. The next component is the residual loss function. So this tries to drive the residue to zero. Okay, so this is simply the square of the residue, and it tries, so if you minimize this, you're driving this to zero. Over here, you have the boundary loss. So here, you try to force the approximation to satisfy the boundary condition points. So these boundary condition points, this is data as well, right? But it might be known ahead of time, you know, from physics considerations. Whereas here, and this is the data also that is given. And here you have the initial condition loss, which forces the approximation to satisfy initial condition points. So this is also data, all right? So this is all data, okay? And this is how you build your loss function. So here's an example of this. So this is the viscous Burgers equation. It's a nonlinear PDE, known in fluid mechanics. And this is the actual solution. And this is the predicted one. And we can see here that it does very well. Okay, so with this simple initial condition, sinusoidal, it shows the evolution. I mean, it predicts the exact solution really well with an approximation network consisting of 8 layers of 20 neurons, 200 initial points, 100 boundary points, and 20,000 collocation points. So I didn't mention the collocation points, I'm sorry. So these are the collocation points. And this is how you measure the residue. So you wanna make the residue go down to zero on the collocation points. The collocation points are not data points. They are randomly selected in the domain, typically using some kind of deterministic sampling or random sampling, mixture of the two, like Latin hypercube sampling. And so in this particular example, we use 20,000 collocation points in the domain, okay? So it does very well, all right? This is a nonlinear PDE, solves it very well, okay? Now, the problem with this original algorithm is that it has trouble with an equation like the Allen-Kahn, for instance, okay? So the Allen-Kahn has very sharp transitions and fast transitions to model this kind of two-phase microstructure. So you can see down here, you can see here that using a similar setup and doing 8,000 Adam iterations, okay, you cannot get the solution, okay? So the blue is the exact solution that you saw before, and the red is what you get, okay? And you can see down here, first of all, the L2 error is almost 100%. But you can see here what the trouble is, okay? It can drive the boundary loss very low, okay? It can push the residual loss also low. So, you know, this solution here satisfies the Allen-Kahn, okay, to a certain extent. But the initial boundary loss is high, okay? I mean, so it cannot, if you cannot approximate the initial condition, then of course it's not gonna be able to capture the evolution. So what people have proposed is to do some adaptive schemes, okay? So for instance, let's put some weights on the initial condition, okay? So let's make the initial condition more important. So the network is forced to satisfy the initial condition, okay? So let's put more weights on the boundary condition or certain areas of the domain, etc. So these are hard-coded adaptive solutions, okay? What we have proposed is a self-adaptive approach, okay? Where we essentially let the neural network learn where it should put more weight. So the network learns where are the difficult spots of the solution. So for instance, if it's an initial condition or near the initial condition, it's gonna learn to put more weights there. You don't have to tell it, you know, put more weights here. The network is gonna learn to do it, okay? So this is in agreement with the general philosophy of deep learning, neural networks, which is to let the network learn, right? Instead of telling it what to do. So the it's a very simple modification where, you know, the loss function now has a multiplicative coefficient. So you just introduce these G lambdas, okay? Where the lambdas are the self-adaptation weights. So now the loss function is a function not only of the network weights, but also of these lambdas, okay? And this G is a mask function, okay? which is going to take this lambda and produce a mask, which is going to multiply over the domain. So it's like an attention mask. Okay, so if you're familiar with attention mechanisms in deep learning, this is a multiplicative attention mask, okay, that you're gonna impose. But you're gonna learn this mask, okay? The way that you're gonna do this is you're gonna minimize the loss with respect to W, but you're gonna maximize it with respect to the lambdas. So that's a big difference with respect to the usual way to train a network. So here you're gonna have a gradient descent ascent approach, okay? So if you look at the basic iteration here of gradient ascent descent, for the network weights, you're gonna do the usual gradient descent. This is the learning rate. This is the gradient with respect to W. But for the adaptation weights, you're gonna do gradient ascent. So you're gonna add the gradient with the learning rate. And if you look at the gradient with respect to these adaptation weights, you're gonna see that provided that G prime is positive, provided that the mask function is increasing, then these gradients are always non-negative, okay? So the gradients are non-negative, meaning it means that the adaptation weights, you can start at a small value and they're gonna start to increase, okay? As they increase, they're gonna start penalize more the areas of the solution where the solution is not converging, okay? Because as you can see, if you go back one slide, you can see that the loss function, as we increase G, you're gonna increase G when this term is not decreasing, okay? That's what you can see from the gradient here, okay? When this term is large, the gradient is large, okay? So, and this term is the error term. So as iteration proceeds, as the network is not converging to over a particular region of the solution, these gradients are gonna increase and you're gonna penalize more that, okay? And this is gonna force the network to converge in that area, all right? It doesn't allow it to do, like, let's say, minimize loss somewhere else to minimize the overall loss. No, it has to minimize the loss here, okay? Whether it's near the initial solution, near the boundary condition, or near sharp transitions of the solution, okay? So Nick, please tell me when I'm running out of time, okay? So here is some examples of mask functions. You can see, you can have polynomial mask functions, you can have sigmoid mask functions. For the sigmoidal mask functions, if you make it sharp, then you can make sharp masks, okay? Because you're gonna start here, the lambda starts small, and then it's gonna be small, and then when lambda reaches a certain value, it just jumps sharply to its largest value. So you get basically a binary mask, okay? So you can make this mask to be very smooth, or you can make it be very sharp by selecting the G function. So here's an example for the Allen-Kahn using the self-adaptive pin. And let me run it, okay? And you'll be able to see that it is able to track it very well, very closely. And you can see that it's able to capture this this transition here between the two modes closely, okay? And this was using 8,000 Adam iterations of gradient ascent, gradient descent ascent, and 8,000 LBFGS iterations, okay? And 2,000 collocation points, 100 initial points, 200 boundary points. So here in the simulation, there's no data interior to the domain. But of course, if you have data interior to the domain, sensor data interior to the domain, then of course, convergence is faster, you know, accuracy is also faster. And you can see here the comparison of the L2 error of the algorithm that of the self-adaptive pin compared to a time-adaptive pin, which is a proposed in a previous paper, which is basically chops down the domain into small bands and tries to do a kind of a time-stepping thing, which we're trying to avoid here because we don't want to do time-stepping. One of the major advantages here is that you can solve the PDE over the entire domain. You don't do time-stepping, right? So you can parallelize this massively over the entire domain. So the time adaptive pin is kind of like a, you know, time stepping through the back door. Okay. And then you have a hard code. Yes.
5 minutes, including Q&A.
Okay. So I'm almost done. So the hard coded adaptive pin is, you know, just puts hard coded weights. It doesn't work very well. It doesn't work well at all. Okay. And the original pin simply doesn't work. It does not converge as I showed you before. So it has a very large L2 error. Ah, okay, so just very quickly here, this is the trained mask function, and you can see which are the solutions that are difficult, which parts of the solution are difficult. You know, you can see that it's precisely near the beginning of the solution, near the initial boundary conditions, and over the two modes. So you can see exactly, later is not that important, but at the beginning is very important to get it correct, and we already knew that. So this is the trained mask function. It learns by itself where it should put attention, okay? All right, so this is my next to last slide. This is the current and future work, you know, so this is a work in progress, as I said. So we are interested in developing this for forward modeling, inverse modeling, uncertainty quantification, and of course, modeling microstructure evolution with our collaborators, Raimundo, his students. And finally, acknowledgements here to Levi, which did the hard work here to get all these results and contributed really important ideas as well. And the D3M training program that supports us, supports Levi. Also the Army Research Lab also has been very important in supporting Levi. And with that, I end my presentation. If you have questions, please let me know.
Well, thanks very much, Ulysses. If the folks have questions, please either write them to everyone in the chat or ask them directly through audio.
Hey, Ulysses.
Yes.
Hi, Sebastian. Great, great presentation. Thank you. I was wondering the sensitivity of the solution to the initial weights, because if all the weights say are initialized at zero, then if they're all positive, they're going to go up. If they're all negative, they're going to go down. But I guess there will be a mixture of signs in the final solution. Absolutely. But in general, have you seen any important sensitivities to the initial weights, or they always converge?
Yes. So yeah, that's a very great question. Thank you, Sebastian. The method is very sensitive to both, to the initialization of both the self-adaptive weights and the network weights. I mean, as all deep learning methods, it's very sensitive to the initialization of the network weights as well. Right now, we are using standard procedures from deep learning. In this case, it's Xavier initialization, okay? But I'm sure that there are better ways to initialize these weights. I mean, we just don't know yet because this is a new area. And we are borrowing a lot of things from, you know, ImageNet, you know, classification of cats and dogs. But there's a lot here we still have to discover. So, and the initialization of the weights is a critical one. If you do not initialize the weights correctly, then yes, you cannot converge. So that's why we did 10 runs with random initialization of weights and took the average in the results I showed, because it can vary depending on the initialization. So this is one of the major areas that we are trying to address. I mean, how to initialize properly, not only the self-adaptive weights, but also the network weights. Something that I didn't mention, just remembered, is that you can also train for parameters of the PDE. So all of these things can be trained. If you train for the parameters of the PDE, you're doing inverse modeling. So let's say that the PDE has some parameters, physical parameters that you don't know. All of these things can be trained. So, but you know, all of these will depend very much on initialization, the training procedure. So here we are using ADAM. Is ADAM the best way to do it? Okay. We are using LBFGS. Is this the best way to do it? Okay. So the training, the initialization, the architecture of the networks, can we automate that, right? Can we find automatically the good architecture? So all of these things are open problems.
Okay, very good. Thank you. If I can ask a follow-up question, but only if nobody else has questions.
Please go ahead.
Okay, thank you. So you, if I understood well, you know, there are two optimization problems nested together. One is apparently convex using a conventional steepest descent algorithm. And then you introduce a new one that you're saying is not a descent, it's an ascent. So I assume you have a function there that is concave rather than convex. But I was wondering, you know, as a function of the initial conditions, maybe the problem could go from being concave to convex or vice versa. I mean, there is always the assumption that there will be the two optimization problems. One is going to be convex and the other one will be concave, and therefore one is steepest descent, the other one is steepest ascent. Or is that going to be always the case, or is it going to be a function of the initial conditions and maybe something else?
That's a good question. So, you know, in deep learning, unfortunately, nothing is convex. And that's one of the knocks on deep learning as compared, for instance, to support vector machines. So, but we have some good understanding of this multiple local minima in deep learning. We know that they are, if the network is deep enough, then this local minima have comparable losses. But it's not convex. Now, in the other direction, in the maximization direction, by designing the mask function and the loss functions correctly, you can get a concave loss, but this is only in the self-adaptive weights. In the network weights, it's not convex, so it is not possible to use convex optimization here, unfortunately. So we have to use gradient ascent, descent, second order methods, and hope that the solution that you get is very close to the optimum.
Okay, well, thanks very much.
Thank you.
We have time for one more question.
Quick question. It has to be really, really quick, both question and answer.
Okay, just Ulysses, have you thought about incorporating more physical meaning to those loss functions in terms of material science?
Yeah, exactly. So right now, the only physical meaning is through the residue. So you have an equation, and that equation drives the residue. Everything else is data, right? So it's so that's how you combine them. You have the residue and the data.
Okay. And Dr. Gilden, if I may, the all of the physics that you program into your model are captured in those collocation in that residual model. All of the physics are.
Okay. Very good. Thank you.
Okay, well, thanks for a great talk and thanks for the questions. Our next speaker is Ben Hu from Computer.